OK, merci d'être venu tout le monde. Donc on va commencer. Oh, pardon. Merci d'être venu tout le monde et sur YouTube aussi. On commence avec une performance d'environ 13 minutes et puis on va mettre les chaises pour un petit séminaire. Mais pendant la performance, on a enlevé les chaises pour que vous puissiez circuler dans la salle et explorer le son de ce dispositif unique. Donc merci et merci à Maxime Achardor qui va nous jouer. Merci à Maxime. Et maintenant, on va commencer à mettre quelques chaises pour une petite séminaire. Et je vais présenter un peu la pièce. Vous pouvez me poser des questions. Vous pouvez poser des questions à Maxime.
5 minutes.
5 minutes. Oui, 5 minutes pour faire les chaises. J'allume le... Oui. Et je vais mettre le power. Allume ça, et c'est 1, 2. J'espère qu'on a du son. Non, c'est depuis. Oui. Oui. Mais ça veut dire que moi, je dis un petit mot pour les gens sur YouTube pendant qu'on prend les chaises.
Ceci dit, je vais devoir faire un truc. Il faut que j'enlève les micros de la diffusion.
Ok.
Ça va faire du feedback.
Et bravo.
Ça s'est bien passé, non ?
Ouais, super. Et la fin, pour moi, c'était la
ouais, super. Ouais. J'ai un peu peur au début, j'entendais pas l'électronique.
C'était un peu faible, peut-être à cause des personnes dans la salle.
D'accord. Je
laisse ça, peut-être. Mais bravo.
Ouais, c'était pas mal. Bon, à un moment, j'ai frotté le micro, mais bon, c'était comme ça.
J'ai pas vraiment entendu. Pour les gens à la maison sur YouTube, donc vous venez d'entendre une performance de nouvelle esquisse pour une œuvre jouée par Maxime Achardot, percussionniste. Et maintenant, je vais présenter un petit séminaire. Ça serait plutôt en anglais, mais vous êtes bienvenus de poser des questions et discuter en français aussi. Je pense qu'on est presque là. Et sur YouTube, vous avez entendu un rendu binaural de l'eau-parleur à 20 canaux au centre de la salle que vous voyez. Donc, normalement, vous aurez entendu à peu près une rendu de cette expérience en 3D, mais sur le casque. OK, donc, welcome. Thanks, everybody, for being here and for being on YouTube at home. So I'm just going to present a brief presentation on the residency that led to this piece and some of our plans for the future coming out of it. So, the title is Prestidigitation, and I'll speak a little bit more about where that comes from. And it's the product of collaboration for 6-7 months with Maxime. We began building together the percussion setup that you saw and working together with it, testing it with the electronic tools. It will have its concert premiere in a couple of months in London. I don't think it will be live streamed, but if anybody's in London, please come and listen. And it's the first sketch, so I think it's not quite still a work in progress, first sketch of what will become a future work for percussion solo, small ensemble, and electronics, and always involving the 3D loudspeaker, the Echo, that's in the middle of the room here. So the origins behind this study. So it's a part of a research residency that I'm doing, supported by a project of the European Research Commission. The title of the project, of which I'm one team member, is Music and Artificial Intelligence, Building Critical Interdisciplinary Studies. It's led by Professor Georgina Born, some of you know, at University College of London. And it's a large team of musicologists, anthropologists, computer music developers, and a composer or two, and, which includes me. My point of departure for my element of the project is to look a little bit at how machine learning and artificial intelligence can be used for space and spatialization. I think it's safe to say that most applications we hear of artificial intelligence are more or less mono stereo. They haven't so far very much considered situated listening, embodied cognition, all of the topics that we as musicians and computer music researchers have known about for a long time, but it seems to me have yet to really be taken up by this machine learning community.
Okay.
So in contrast, one of the sort of first goals of this project is to use machine learning to quote unquote re-embody the spatial presence of a live instrument and a live instrumentalist. How do we go about doing that? Well, we of course know that acoustic instruments have very rich spatial patterns, spatial radiation patterns. Lots of research has been done on that by some of the people here. And there have been some attempts to reconstruct those instrumental radiation patterns using higher order ambisonics, either in a ambisonic dome, not yet to my knowledge with a spherical loudspeaker array, unless somebody else knows of some work that's yet been done on that. And one of the, I think, distinctive features of this project is that the sound radiation patterns come from natural acoustic data. So we're not using any kinds of spatialization models. We're not using virtual sources. All of the sound that you hear coming out of the loudspeaker is somehow modeled on live acoustic instruments in three dimensions. So where is this data coming from? Two sources primarily. The first is a large database of measured radiation patterns of acoustic instruments recorded at TU Berlin. I'll say more about that in a second. The next one is the spherical microphone, the EigenMic, that you also see in front of you, and that's being used for live amplification and processing in the electronic part of the piece. And these two models or these two sources of information are intentionally superposed in the composition to create an intentional confusion between what is a live source and what is a modeled source from other instruments. The EigenMic. So about the TU database, this is a freely available database. It was made around 2017 by Stefan Weinzierl and colleagues in Berlin. And it features 41 orchestral and historical instruments recorded in an anechoic chamber with a 32-channel surrounding microphone dome. These can be represented, obviously, in the spherical harmonic domain. And in this case, it's 25 coefficients. That's fourth order spherical harmonics. There's not, to any of our knowledge, a higher resolution such database in existence yet. I'm sure in the future there will be interest in that as we go into bigger and bigger higher order ambisonics. But for the moment, this is the most detailed one that I know of. And here are just some images. To the left, you see some photos that the TU provided of the instrumentalist in the anechoic chamber. To the right are some of our visualizations with SPAT of the radiation patterns that are in the database. And some of you may have heard a few years ago a first use of some of this data in an earlier work, Cosmologies for Piano and 3D Electronics. The sort of goal of that project was to situate the listener's head in the middle of a virtual giant grand piano inside of an ambisonic dome. And interestingly, the TU database doesn't include data for piano, so it was a sort of interesting question challenge. How do we model the piano? How do we use the TU database to model the piano? And what we did is, I spent a lot of time right here in Studio 5 with that piano, doing terrible things to it on the interior, with different objects, preparations, et cetera, recorded all with the EigenMic in 32 channels, which also coincidentally could be encoded with the same resolution as the TU database. The premiere was with Alvise Sinivia at Centre Pompidou. IRCAM Live, March 5th, 2020, the last concert before Corona. To my knowledge, it was the first connection of audio descriptor analysis, corpus-based synthesis, spatialization with higher order ambisonics and machine learning techniques. It's also, again, to my knowledge, the first use of the EigenMic in a live performance context. It's more often used for recording research purposes, but we thought it was an interesting idea to use it in live performance. It was the first fully realized project of OM Sharp, which was a companion to Open Music that Jean Bressois was working on at the time. And we used OM Sharp to model some of the spatial processes in that piece using the OM SPAT library and some of the connections to concatenative synthesis using the OM ISMM library. So here I am right here in Studio 5 recording the piano. And here's a few images of Alvise performing the work. And a little bit about the software that was implemented for that, which in turn is part of the piece that you just heard. So first of all, we have corpus-based synthesis using the Mubu package. So here's a version of CatArt Mubu. This is similar to a patch that you can find in the forum called Cat Oracle. And so on the right, you can see the large database of piano samples, which were then diffused in the Cosmologies piece in response to the live pianist. An advance that we made at that time, which is carried forward into the current percussion piece, is to use Mubu and corpus-based synthesis to encode directly in ambisonic sound. So you see a Mubu concat, a concatenative synthesis motor on the left, and that is directly outputting higher order ambisonic encoded data to be added and then decoded by SPAT in space. So it's a very efficient way to have theoretically arbitrarily large amount of spatial polyphony. So you can have many grains going at once, all with different radiation patterns, and they're all added and decoded into the 3D loudspeaker, either ambisonic dome or 3D spherical loudspeaker array. Where does the machine learning come in? Well, there is KNN inside of Mubu to do matching of live gestures to synthesized gestures, so that's a little bit of machine learning. The more advanced bit of machine learning is from a Mubu GMM, which helps the patch decide how to spatialize arbitrary sounds in its database. So as mentioned, the piano database includes sounds that we don't know their radiation patterns from Teu. Similarly, as we'll talk about here, Maxime and I essentially built together a new percussion setup, which of course we don't have data on its radiation pattern. And so instead, we ask Mubu to attempt to guess what instrument the sounds most resemble, and then use the radiation pattern of that instrument to spatialize the sound. So it's not, there's no ground truth, there's no right answer. Is a bodhrán more like a tuba or a trombone? I don't know. But the acoustic results and the compositional results, I think, are very interesting to hear what it sounds like when the bodhrán sound is then diffused as if it had the radiation pattern of a tuba, for example. And a new element in the new piece, the percussion piece, which actually goes back to a residency I did here quite a few years ago, involves computer improvisation in the process as well. So that's using Cat Oracle, as I mentioned, which you can find on the forum. Cat Oracle implements a version of PyOracle, which is a Python library for computer improvisation. It's very that's by Greg Sergis and Shlomo Dubnov. And it's very much part of the Factor Oracle family that many of you know well. So it uses similar computer improvisation algorithms to OMAX, SOMAX, DC2. So in particular, the Oracle is a Factor Oracle or an Audio Oracle, which is a sort of extension of the Factor Oracle. Originally, this was kind of broken for a few years due to the loss of 32-bit architecture in Max. So now I fixed it. The patch communicates with Python through the terminal, and hopefully that'll be nice and stable for the future. And so that's all updated for Python 3 point whatever, and should be working on everybody's machines now. And one of the motivations for building this tool in a way myself, rather than using, for example, OMAX, was I wanted access to the full list of descriptors available in Mubu as a source of data for the improvisation. So as a goal, we could say it's a kind of computer noise improvisation. So rather than pitch and duration being the primary inputs to the improvisation algorithm, I'm using the full list of earcom descriptors. And I see Jérôme smiling because I think DC2 is also doing that these days. But I think we had similar goals to get that working. Here's an image from PyOracle. You'll see resembles OMAX, et cetera. Then, of course, the major change in the new project was rather than using an ambisonic dome, we were interested in exploring the ECHO, this 20-sided speaker that you see in the middle of the room. j'ai dit grand-chose. And there are a few reasons this seemed to be a logical next step. So one is, if you think of those images of the Te'u data, they were recorded radiating out from an instrumentalist to a surrounding sphere of microphones. And actually, in a way, it makes sense to diffuse that from a centered source in the room rather than, in a sense, inside out from an ambisonic dome. So I think ever since we worked on cosmologies, we were interested in how that data would actually sound diffused in this other way. And in a sense, in a bit more logical, because now the spherical loudspeaker array is a kind of virtual instrumentalist. It's similar to the instrumentalist sitting in the middle of the anechoic chamber. Also, of course, there's the advantage that we no longer have issues of sweet spot, or at least not the same issues. So rather than having a limited sweet spot in the middle of an ambisonic dome, now everybody in the room has some kind of spatial experience. As I hope you heard during the performance, those experiences are different. So depending on where you're standing in relation to the speaker and in relation to the percussionist, it's very much transforms the sound and the results. But I think that's a feature rather than a bug in this case. And it encourages a kind of active listening and active motion of the audience, which in my view, the ICO really is almost requires. I think a seated concert with the ICO is maybe less interesting. The ICO, as some of you know, is a commercial product. It's developed by IEM and Graz and Sonable, which is a company there. So it's also nicely transmissible. We're going to perform in London with a different ICO, but we can be fairly certain that it will have the same parameters and the same behavior. So that's another convenience of using such a piece of equipment. And so now a bit more about the musical thought that went into the piece, because that's all been a little technical, but I also want to talk about music. So what considerations are needed to project sound with the ECHO, and what kind of a live acoustic setup would be an interesting setup to build for that projection? And so this, of course, was the product of a large amount of time of collaboration with Maxime. We went together to Anson Donné's studio in Montreuil. We explored his different instruments, Rémy's instruments, whatever we found. We explored some instruments that are homemade by Maxime, so they're one of a kind. The piece cannot be easily performed by another percussionist unless they get permission from Maxime to borrow his seashells. But I find this a positive rather than a negative, that this is a highly personalized setup and a highly personalized piece. And a few sort of aesthetic creative themes that emerged during the process. So the title, Prestidigitation, obviously a kind of double entendre between the fast fingers of the virtuosic percussionist and an idea of kind of magic sleight of hand, the virtual instruments hidden inside the loudspeaker, and in a way, maybe a little bit of a broader commentary on AI in our culture, which to me seems to be taking on some of the dimensions that magic, ritual, shamanism have at other times. We ask search engines to tell us what kind of music we should listen to. We ask the audio oracle what kind of improvisation it should play. In fact, and oracle isn't even my idea, but whoever invented that machine learning algorithm already was making a connection to the idea of an oracle, a divinely inspired piece of information. Another concern I hope you noticed is the sort of amusing and productive contrast between hi-fi and lo-fi. On the one hand, we have homemade instruments, one-of-a-kind instruments made from natural materials, made from seashells, metal, etc. On the other side, we have very much high-tech, quote-unquote, scientific equipment being used to diffuse that sound. And I think that tension is interesting, rather than, for example, some really clean synthesis being diffused with the ECHO, which is interesting also, but obviously not the goal in this piece. We've already talked about the idea of situated presence, the idea that rather than sitting stationary, the audience is encouraged to move in the space and change their relationships to the sound. I hope some of you had a chance to walk behind the speaker, in between the speaker and the percussion on the side. From our experiments in the studio with Maxime, we found that those were all very different experiences and informed our perception in interesting ways. Another topic, which I'll expand a little bit on, the sort of idea of agency and material agency, who's controlling whom in this situation. So we began with some improvisations that Maxime did in the studio in Montreuil. I then spent months analyzing those recordings in 32 channels to find out exactly what Maxime did when, which instruments he played, at what times. I then did a compositional process to reinterpret that into the score. I sort of decomposed those analyses, split them up, put different elements of them at different parts of the piece, and then built them back together. And actually, there is one moment about around the middle of the piece where you hear more or less the transcription of the original improvisation, which Maxime now reinterprets through notation. The computer is listening live, the audio oracle, and capturing that data. Important to say, not only capturing descriptor data from EARCOM descriptors, but now also capturing spatialization data from the 3D radiation patterns that each of those sounds have been mapped to. The computer at different times in the piece performs a live improvisation, so it's quite unpredictable. As Maxime and I saw, there are times I don't quite know what's going to come out and we need to react, and Maxime also needs to react. And actually, through the compositional process, we realized that what started as a more or less totally notated score actually needed a little more flexibility. And so we ended up revising and building in several passages where Maxime is free to improvise within certain constraints, but more or less freely, which then dovetail with parts that are fully notated. Here's just a little glimpse of the improvisation, which we did back in January. You heard a bit what that sounds like, so we don't need to go too far. But I think it's interesting that this was Maxime's first encounter with these instruments. I think it was the same day we sort of built the setup the first time. And so I also found something special about that sort of initial encounter that later when we recorded some other improvs, which I may use for the future piece, but they have a different quality because Maxime has really begun to master the setup, whereas in that improv, it's still very much exploring, getting to understand the setup. Here's just a page from the score showing there on the second line, you can see how the detailed transcription looks. So that is elements of that original improvisation that I've transcribed and that Maxime plays from notation. But then you see the dark lines are where the computer is going to begin an improvisation. So where it says Q14 on the third line, the computer has just learned from what Maxime just played and now does its improvisation based on that. And then you see the rectangle just above. Maxime now will respond live in performance to what the computer does with his own improvisation, just constrained by the particular instruments that he's using so that we sort of create an interesting dialogue between the instruments the computer's using then and the instruments Maxime's using. So a few remarks about this. I think in a way it's a fairly novel spatialization paradigm in that it doesn't involve modeling of virtual sources. We heard a lecture at the forum from about Dolby Atmos. You know what? There is no way to make this Dolby Atmos. There are no point sources. There are no virtual sources moving around. Every sound is diffused through a fourth order spherical or third order spherical harmonic. It's also, I believe, a novel approach to the eco. Most, I think, of the work with the eco has been using some kind of focused beams. And in a way, that's what the eco was built for, to project a focused beam toward the reflective walls of a room. So we're doing something quite different by diffusing the EigenMic into the eco. But we also realized, and also through hearing some other work, like the conference that we heard with the eco back in November, that just doing that isn't enough. It doesn't quite work. There's actually no reason it should work. And so what we actually did was a kind of hybrid approach where, so what you've just heard, there is live diffusion from the EigenMic to the eco mixed with focused beams which track the loudest sound of the percussion. So there's a dynamically moving virtual hypercardioid microphone in the patch. It's looking at the signal from the EigenMic and choosing which way to point based on the loudest sound. And then that particular sound is amplified as a kind of point source in the eco and remixed with the EigenMic signal. So if you like, it's kind of the best of both worlds. There's the full detail of the acoustic audio coming from the EigenMic, plus this sort of intensive, more intensive focus on one point in the 3D field coming from the focused beam. That's just an image of how that looks in the patch. So we have the eigenmic coming in sort of in the middle and then being analyzed to find the direction to point the virtual hypercardioid microphone you see on the right. And then those are mixed together, and that's what you heard as the live diffusion for the percussion. A bit more towards future directions. So in the course of this work, I was, it was on the first slide, but I didn't say out loud. Of course, I haven't been mentioning the IRCOM collaborators with whom I worked very intensively, Thibaut Carpentier and Dimo Schwartz. And so everything you've been seeing, obviously, couldn't have been done without them. And in particular, some of the questions we posed about this work led Thibaut to do some novel research on acoustics regarding spherical correlation. So we sort of asked the question, well, if the audio oracle is going to be navigating between different spatialization patterns, or if the percussion is going to trigger different spatialization patterns, can we make any generalizations about how those spatialization patterns move or how they compare to each other? And so Thibaut proposed the idea of a spherical correlation measure of how similar two spherical radiation patterns are. So it seems that some people had done research on this in visuals, but this was relatively new in audio. And so we reported on that at the acoustics conference in April, and we're going to continue working on that. It led to a sort of further idea of we could now take pairwise comparisons of any two radiation patterns, and using MATLAB and MUBU together, we can use multidimensional scaling to build a kind of directivity space, a directivity browser. We intend to combine this with the audio oracle for future machine learning tasks to see what happens if the oracle sort of walks around this radiation space. Here's just an image of what that looks like. So this is, as a kind of test case, the full TEU database, the 41 instruments of the TEU database, and we've used Thibaut's correlation algorithm to plot them in a two-dimensional MDS, multidimensional scaling reduction, and we see some interesting comparisons. You know, some behavior we'd expect, the double bass and the cello are right next to each other, for example, or clarinet and flute are not far away, contrabassoon. But we hope we'll also find some interesting things when we plug in less predictable sound sources. So that's going to be some future work. But what you have already heard is, as I already mentioned, of course, the oracle is connected to the spatialization pattern. So every time the oracle chooses a state in machine improvisation, it's chosen with its unique radiation pattern. And so as a result, when we hear a succession of sounds in the computer improvisation, we're also hearing a succession of dynamically changing radiation patterns. And so I hope that this gives the computer improviser an interesting behavior in space. He's not just, she, it is not just projecting in the dimension I tell, in the direction I tell it, it's choosing which direction each sound should radiate. And when I say direction, what I really mean is a 3D radiation pattern. So those are just a few examples. And oh yeah, here, apologies, the was a little too much for my video card, apparently. You can see some delays in the video on the right. But anyway, as you see, the improviser is navigating the oracle structure on the left, and each time it changes state, it chooses a new radiation pattern on the right. We're just hearing that in stereo. Sorry, the demo is not in 3D anymore. So just a conclusion. So as said, this was a study for what's going to become a work for percussion and small ensemble. We hope with Maxime as soloist with Ensemble Lance Tandonnet. It's great to have Rémy and Emmanuel here. We also think that there's a kind of obvious theatrical dimension to the work. You already saw that in a first form in Maxime's performance, but we think that there's more to work with there. And so, for example, it could be interesting when Maxime enters to have a spotlight just on him with no instruments visible, and then gradually reveal each of the instruments sort of like a magician as the piece begins to unfold. Similarly, perhaps the ensemble also isn't visible at the beginning. We see the solo percussionist enter the stage and begin the work, but at a certain point, we realize that actually there are other performers on stage as well, and we begin to hear sounds slowly mix into the percussion world from them. And then, of course, I think what it makes sense not only that Maxime responds with some improvisations to the computer improvisation, but then the performers of the ensemble also begin to have some short, constrained improvisations, and in turn have the computer respond to those. So I think the work will end up with a sort of unpredictable dialogue between human improvisation and machine improvisation back and forth. So just to end, you can download Cat Oracle, the sort of basis of the improvisation algorithm in the forum. You can also download a sort of slightly simplified version of an ambisonic concatenative synthesis patch. So that's in one of the CatArt Mubu examples also in the forum. So the two sort of main parts of the machine learning in the piece you can test out yourself at home. Many thanks and references. Obviously, a project like this relies on a lot of people to make it possible, and I'm really grateful for all of their support, and the ERC as well. So thank you very much. Thanks for coming. Okay, merci Sylvie. Yes. Yeah, so questions for me, or I think also welcome questions for Maxime or Dimo or Thibault if you have them. All right, we don't have the capacity to take questions from YouTube, do we? Or probably not. Ah oui, ah. Oui. Donc, Maxime Bachador, percussionniste.
So I have to present myself in English?
No, okay. No.
Okay. No, I can do it in English if people are watching from Sydney or, I don't know, Hong Kong. Yes, I am a percussion player from Paris and now working for more than 20 years with our ensemble, which is called L'Instant Donné, and we have here in this room our two managers, coordinators, and many other stuff that you deal with. And so I have been now working for many years in IRCAM during for many projects, and this one is really typical because it's one of the first time that I have to deal with the thing I like to do, which is building new kind of stands, because I had never seen this, and it was built really because Aaron needed something very special for his speed, the idea of the microphone, which need a surrounding sound, which is quite something new for musician, how to deal with that idea. And so for me, I am really happy to see today that this project take a new shape, because we have now tried a first version of the piece. And yes, I like the idea that you mentioned, that working with a very specialized new technologies and some of the oldest instruments that we can imagine in the world, like just chimes. And yes, I think that it will go far. Thanks.
Thank you, Maxime. And just a comment on that, I don't know if you appreciated during the performance how the sort of millimeter tolerance Maxime sometimes had to avoid hitting the microphone as he operated in the setup. So that's also an unsung virtuosity that it nonetheless took a lot of practice.
Well, thank you both very much for the piece and the presentation. I really enjoyed listening to that. And I also enjoyed all the explanations about your thought, your way of your thoughts about working together, because I think it implements quite other relationship between composer and interpreter, which is getting more open. You haven't been talking so much about the audience, because obviously here we are in a space which is built to not reflect. And we also have a limited distance that you could exploit between like what we hear, the direct sound from the instruments. And I observed also in my own practice that that's also always a very sensitive balance if you work with like live instruments and electronics, being it spatialized or not, because you don't know always how much you can control the distance of the audience between both of them. And I was interested to know a bit more about if that was something you have been already working on. Would it be more part of the next step?
Yeah, thank you. Fantastic question from one of the experts on space and sound. So indeed, I think I had the experience when we heard your presentation in November with Natasha Barrett and Andrew Knight Hill that, in a way, we also need to kind of learn to listen to this speaker. You know, we all have formation in how we deal with traditional speakers, but this speaker behaves quite differently in space. And indeed, probably some of you noticed that when you're very close, the sound is quite distorted spatially. I in a way, I think less successful. And so it requires a little bit of distance to really make sense. And that's partially because of reflections, and the speaker is designed to work with room reflections. Here, we're in a dry studio space, which in some ways is the worst place for it. So I think absolutely in the future, we will be thinking about what other spaces we can use. I think if circumstances allow, we would love to have the next piece in the ESPRO, because we could actually do quite interesting things there with the reflective panels, et cetera. But there are also other spaces with interesting reflective walls that could be useful. But at the same time, I think for today, we decided to treat the dry room sort of as a plus rather than a minus. And it was really, that was one of the reasons we wanted the audience to be able to move. Because I think in a dry space with the echo, sitting still kind of is a bit beside the point, because you don't really benefit from most of what the speaker can do. So I think in a dry space, the only way to get sort of an interesting experience is to move around the speaker. In a wet space, I think it could be an interesting tension, and I think that's a question for the future, how we will work with that, how we'll build it into the piece. But at the same time, because it's a different way of using the echo, so it's not the kind of focused beam projection approach, I also think that maybe it requires some rethinking of how to situate the echo. So I think, for example, I think that these eigenmic sounds in the echo worked better in a dry space than a focused beam would, because they didn't rely as much on wall reflections. But of course, with raw reflections, we'd have a lot more we can do. So, yeah.
I'm not sure if I express myself very clearly. I think because that's one part of that question was very much related to what you say, that Jan, because we don't have now only the ICO, that if you work with pre-recorded sources only or virtual sources would be the case. But actually, I was also talking about the direct sound of the percussion, which is very subtle and very enjoyable. In that very piece, and as an audience, you would probably want to navigate between those two instruments in the space.
Okay, thank you for pointing out that I missed that interesting part of your question. I mean, I think that was also part of how we thought about the setup in the room today, and I was glad to see some people even walk behind Maxime. Maybe we could have encouraged more to really have people circulate in every direction, because I think one of the sort of ideals that I had in the piece, and I think Maxime explored really beautifully, was, you know, how we can give the audience the impression of being in Maxime's place. You know, how does the listening of the percussionist right next to the setup differ from the way we usually hear a performance? And how can we give the audience an experience that begins to approach something like that, or something related to that experience? So yeah, I think having some relationship between the audience and the acoustic sound is really interesting. At the same time, it does kind of limit what kind of a setup we could build, or if there's an ensemble, where they're going to sit, or that. So I think those are still open questions. But I also think that there's an interesting opposite possibility, which is the kind of, you know, prestidigitation, almost ventriloquism, that I also like moments where Maxime is playing something so quiet that you can barely hear the direct sound. and your only source of information is from the amplified sound. And actually, I think some of those are the most magical moments for me in the piece. And so I think working with that in a bigger space could be really interesting, where Maxime is far enough that the public actually won't hear much direct sound from him at times and only receives the virtual image. So I think between those two extremes, there's some really interesting tension to explore.
Yeah, thank you very much. Wonderful work, and thank you for the concert. I have two questions. The first one is, did you have tried in a way more stable sound through the setup? I mean, you know, percussive sounds are really distorted in a way, unstable in the phase spaces. So have you tried this with more stable sounds like harmonics or something? And the second question is, yeah, for me as a listener, it's not really easy to understand what are the choices you made for going through the directivities from the various sounds in live. And so from your point of view, from your experience, what is maybe the more enjoyable situation from your situation where you would like to go through in a direction through you reinforce the sound and the directivities from the original player, or go on the opposite way to make more contrasts and go in completely opposite way of what is the source sound, and just to make things happen in a completely different way.
Okay, thank you. Really, really interesting advanced questions. So maybe I'll start with the second part to say, indeed, I think for this study, for this presentation, we were mostly going with similarity. So sounds are presented in a radiation pattern that the algorithm finds the most similar, which I sort of confirmed through my experimentation worked the best. So we don't have, for example, very high chime being diffused with a big omni radiation pattern as if it were a timpani or something, because the patch wouldn't make that decision. So I have to say I haven't tested that, but it's a really interesting question to take advantage of the situation to do something that an acoustic sound absolutely would never do. So yes, absolutely. Similarly, with the EigenMic and the focused beam, again, it was always going with amplifying the focused beam in the direction of the highest amplitude. We could send the focus beam in a different direction. I have to say, when I tried that in the studio, it sounded pretty ugly to my ears, because you would suddenly blow up some background noise really loud or blow up a part of the sound that isn't the most perceptually salient, and suddenly it's kind of in your face. So in my, just to give a concrete example, so in some of the early experiments, I put some field recordings through the echo, and for the most part, I thought they sounded terrible. Well, no, that's wrong. They didn't sound the way you would expect, let's say. I think Thibault maybe remarked at one point, it sounded almost like you were looking through a tiny hole in a door into an audio scene. So maybe it's not a bad thing, but it's definitely different from a field recording diffused in an ambisonic dome, for example. And then I tried some focused beams on those field recordings, and again, very strange results. For example, if it was a crowd sound that I had recorded with the EigenMic, with a focused beam, it sounded to my composerly ear quite bad. Like you sort of heard big amplitude changes all over the place as a sound came from there, a sound came from there, a sound came from there. But then I took an EigenMic recording of the street, and it actually was pretty successful because the focused beam followed a motorcycle, and then it followed a truck, and then it followed somebody else. And so that actually produced kind of audio objects that move through the space. And that's beginning to be a little bit like some of what Natasha does with it, I think, in her use of field recordings with Eco. So I think that whole area is a huge place to explore. I don't know if this project will involve field recordings, probably not, but it is something I do in my other work. We've talked a lot with Demo about using the Oracle for kind of audio scene improvisation. Could it sort of take a field recording and continue the ambience of the field recording? And I think maybe with the spatial side added, that could be a really interesting possibility. But again, probably for a different creative project, but that's fine. So yeah, I hope that kind of...
Have you tried about harmonical sounds?
Oh, sorry, the last one. Well, okay, we're the last comment because we have to end. So the Teiu database is made with sustained tones. So there is a little bit of a contradiction here that we're taking radiation patterns for sustained harmonic sounds and applying them to percussion sounds with lots of transients. I guess I haven't really done, I mean, the closest would be the sort of supervol sounds on the Bodron, or in my piano piece, there are some sort of low sustained pitches. And I find the results convincing in a way, you know, when they're diffused with a tuba or trombone radiation pattern, they seem to me to fill the space in a way that sounds satisfying. But again, I think they're, yeah, a really interesting topic to pursue. All right, that's all the time we have for it. So thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Maxime. Bravo again.